I invite you to open your Bibles with us to the book of 2 Samuel, chapter number 21. 2 Samuel, chapter number 21, as we continue our study through the life of David. And we're going to be looking at really about the first nine verses here this morning. 2 Samuel, chapter number 21. I was reading the other day an article in Psychology Today. And in that particular article, it was discussing some research that had been done that the research proved how the actions of one can affect others. And in that article, it went on to discuss the idea that in Western culture today, that it's really all about the individual and about individual rights without thinking about how that the actions of one can affect others. And I thought, you know, that's sad, but yet that is so true. And in the article, it pointed out one particular area of research where they had gathered together some groups of people, and they gathered together a second group of people. And in the first group, they had them read a story about an individual that had made a lot of money. And then the other story was read by the second group that had nothing to do with the idea of making money. And the research proved that those that read the story about the guy making money, they were more likely to go out and try to make money themselves, and also to really invest a lot of effort in the opportunities before them in increasing their finances. And the bottom line of that research was that the actions of one always have an impact on others. And there was a statement in that article that concluded something like this. It said that the borders of our actions are usually broader than we think. And that's so true. The borders of our actions are usually broader than we think. Our actions have great ramifications upon others, whether it's positive or whether it's negative. And here in this particular story from the life of David, we're going to look at that idea. And I want to speak this morning on the subject of food from a hungry land. Food from a hungry land. So look, if you will, in 2 Samuel 21, and we'll begin reading at verse number 1. In verse 1 it says, "Now there was a famine in the days of David 3 years, year after year. And David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered, 'It is for Saul and for his bloody house, because he slew the Gibeonites.' And the king called the Gibeonites and said unto them," now the Gibeonites were not of the children of Israel, but of the remnant of the Amorites. And the children of Israel had sworn unto them, and Saul sought to slay them in his zeal to the children of Israel and Judah." In other words, he carried out this dastardly deed simply to try to remain popular among the Israelites. Verse number 3 says, "Wherefore David said unto the Gibeonites, 'What shall I do for you, and wherewith shall I make the atonement, that you may bless the inheritance of the Lord?'" So what can I do for you based on what Saul has done to your family so that you can be a blessing to us as Jewish people? Verse 4 and says, "And the Gibeonites said unto him, 'Well, we will have no silver nor gold of Saul, nor of his house, neither for us shalt thou kill any man in Israel.' And he said, 'What ye shall say, that will I do for you.' And so they answered the king and the man that consumed us and that devised against us that which we should be destroyed from remaining in any of the coast of Israel. Here's what we want you to do. Let 7 men of his sons be delivered unto us, and we will hang them up unto the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, whom the Lord did choose. And the king said, 'I will give them to you.'" Verse 7, "But the king spared Mephibosheth." Now, I'm not going to read the other couple of verses because it just mentions the names of those who were hung that I cannot pronounce. But if you look down at the latter part of verse number 14, this interesting statement, "And after they did this, that God was entreated or pleased or satisfied for the land." Now, I have entitled this message this morning, "Food from a Hungry Land," Because really there is some great spiritual food that we can chew on here from this hungry land. This land, David as its leader, and all of the Israelites, they were experiencing great hunger because a famine had been in the land for 3 years. Now, obviously, when we read this story about these seven sons or descendants of Saul and them being hung for what Saul had done, we kind of get a problem with that. You know, we struggle when we read stuff like that because we are looking through New Testament eyes. But what we have to realize is that this story took place during a time when people were living under law and not grace. It took, it was a period of time when it was an experience of the Israelites and not the church. So we have to keep that in mind, but nevertheless, there are some tremendous spiritual principles that we can learn from this. Now, friend, here is a section of Scripture that I'll guarantee you that if I were not preaching through the life of David, there's no way that I would choose this to preach a sermon from on Sunday morning. In fact, I listed to the Lord a lot of different reasons why I should not deal with this chapter. And He listed for me one reason why I should, and that's because He was leading me to do so. And so here we go. We're going to give it our best shot and see if we can make sense of this and application as well. Now, as we think about this famine, there are three things that I want us to notice from it. Number one is the culmination of the famine. Now, verse number one actually indicates to us that there were two things that culminated from this famine. And the first thing was David praying. We see that in verse 1 when it says there was a famine in the days of David, 3 years, year after year, and then David inquired of the Lord. I think that all of us would agree that this famine that had been occurring for 3 years, it was a severe trial in the life of David. And I think that David teaches us a valuable lesson here, and that is that David took this trouble and he brought this trial before the Lord. And that was a wise thing to do. You see, dear friend, any time that we face a trial in life, one of the best things that we can do is to bring that trial before the Lord to see if perhaps the cause of that trial is not the chastening hand of God. Because if we don't come before the Lord and try to find out the reasoning behind the trial, the cause of the trial, then we will never be able to determine whether or not that perhaps it is of the chastening hand of God. Let me tell you something about trials. All trials are not the result of the chastening of the Lord. But some trials are the result of the chastening of the Lord. And you see, if we come to the Lord and we inquire of the Lord and we discover that we are facing this trial because God is chastening us, then what happens? We can learn the lesson that God wants us to learn through the experience, and then we can say goodbye to our trial. But if we don't come before the Lord and honestly ask God to search our hearts and see if perhaps the reason for our trouble is that God is trying to get our attention, then we will never learn the lesson that God is trying to teach us. And let me tell you something else. Even if God does not answer us immediately and reveal to us what the cause of the trial is, it is still always wise to pray. Because as we come before the Lord and as we pray, even if God doesn't give us the immediate answer to the cause, God will give us strength, God will give us grace, God will give us wisdom, God will give us encouragement that we might endure the trial that we are facing. There's something I have learned about facing trials in life, and I'll bet some of you have learned it as well. And that is that I have learned that during the trials of life, listen, there is nothing that will put the peace of God in my heart like trusting the Lord during those trials. And you see, I'll never trust the Lord until I begin to talk to the Lord. And it's amazing how that when I shut myself up in my prayer closet, how that God will remove the dull edges, you might say, from my trust life. And so if I'm struggling with trusting God, the greatest thing that I can do is to spend some time in my prayer closet alone with God. There was something that David, I think, learned many, many times from the examples of the great patriarchs. And that is he learned how to trust God. For example, we read over in the book of Psalms, just jot these verses down, Psalm 22, verses 4 and 5. David writing here, and he says, "Our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee, and they were delivered. They trusted in thee, and they were not confounded." So over and over again, David says, when I look at the great heroes of the faith in my life, the one thing that I see is that they had this great trust in God. Do you realize, friends, that we will never trust a God that we do not know? And we will never know a God that we do not talk to. And so if we want to elevate the trust level in our lives, we elevate our prayer life. You know, I think David was wise here in inquiring of the Lord. I really think that David's process of thinking was, you know what? I really need to come to the sender of the trial because he's the only one that can remove it. And even if he chooses not to remove the trial, he's going to give me the next best thing. He's going to give me a plan for living with it. You know, if I were to go to the doctor and the doctor tells me, "Craig, you've got a disease, and I'm sorry, we're not going to be able to cure it. It's going to be with you for the rest of your life. But I tell you what, Craig, I can give you a treatment plan. And if you will follow that plan, you will be able to enjoy life even though this problem is going to remain." I would say, "Thank you, doc." You see, when we come to the Lord in prayer, when we're facing a serious trial, some of those trials are like that. They're not going to be removed. They're going to stay with us maybe for the rest of our life. But as we come to the great physician, he will give us a treatment plan, you might say, whereby not only will we survive that trial, but we will be able to thrive in the midst of that trial. And friends, that is one of the great lines of demarcation, I would say, between those who are servants of God and those who are not. It's even in the midst of the trial that we trust Him, that we learn, love Him, that we serve Him, that we walk with joy and victory. And that comes as a result of coming to the Lord in prayer and learning to trust Him. You know, really the first counsel that we ought to seek when we are facing a great trial is the counsel of the one who knows all things. And yet, isn't it amazing sometimes how we will seek the counsel of everybody under the sun, but the counsel of the one who is omniscient, who knows every single thing? That's the first counsel we ought to appeal to. And yet, David didn't do that initially. As a matter of fact, the proper reading of this text indicates that David did not pray until 3 years. 3 years of living in the trial. And then he finally came to the Lord and he inquired of the Lord. He was late in his praying. I guess that we could say that when it comes to prayer, it's better late than never, but it's always best to be right on time. You see, prayer should never be our last chance. It should always be our first choice. The first thing that we ought to seek to do is to come to the Lord in prayer. But aren't we just like David? Many times we just won't pray until the pain becomes unbearable. And I think that's where David was. At the end of the 3 years of this famine, then the Bible says that David came before the Lord and he prayed. Do you realize that he could have shortened considerably the time of his trial if he would have sought the Lord earlier in prayer? If he'd have just come to God when it first started and said, "Lord, what's the cause of this thing?" Then he could have gotten rid of the trial much sooner. But he didn't. He waited and he waited and he waited. And finally, he came before the Lord in prayer. Friend, let me tell you something about God's trials as a result of the hand of God's chastening. And I know something about this because I'm so hard-headed that the Lord does have to chasten me sometimes to get my attention. And I've discovered that usually when God sends a trial to get our attention, usually they are small trials at first. And if we'll pay attention to the small trials, they will not turn into big ones. But so many times we pay no attention to the small one, and then all of a sudden it becomes larger and larger. And when the lighter stimulus works, there's no reason for the heavier stimulus. Back when I was in middle school, If I would have listened to the corrective words of my teacher, I never would have had to experience the fiery paddle of my principal, who, by the way, looked like he was impersonating the Hulk. He was the largest man I'd ever seen. Most people were large around me anyway, but he was really large. And you know, the songwriter had it so right. When the songwriter said, "Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer." And so we see then, first of all, the idea of the culmination of the famine, and it culminated in David praying. But it also culminated in God answering, because verse 1 says that David inquired of the Lord, and then the Lord answered him. So David prayed, and God answered. Would you say this morning that you could think of something that God can't do? You know, we say God's God and God can do anything, but no, there's one thing God can't do. God cannot answer a prayer that is not prayed. So if we don't pray it, God's not going to answer it. But if we do pray, God is going to hear us. What so blesses me about this story is that God didn't turn a deaf ear to David. Even though David was tardy for the bell of prayer, you might say, God didn't shut him out. God heard him. God answered him. God didn't turn a deaf ear. And dear friend, if God didn't turn a deaf ear to David, God will not turn a deaf ear to you. Jeremiah said, "Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not." Jesus said, "Ask, and you shall receive. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you." Dear friend, if you find yourself today in a famine, and I really believe that I'm speaking to some today, right now, you are in a famine. You know, it may be a financial famine. It may be a family famine. It may be a famine in your relationships. It may be a famine in your spirit. Maybe there's a spiritual famine going on, and there's this great spiritual drought in your soul, and you just can't figure out what's going on, but your heart doesn't seem to be as close to God as it once did, and you can just read your Bible, and it's like the Spirit of God is no longer speaking to you, and you're praying, and it seems like it's just bouncing off the wall and going nowhere. And you come to worship, and we sing these great songs, and there was a time that you would like to raise your hands in praise to God, but now there is a drought going on in your soul. Pastor, what do I need to do? Talk to God. Friend, if you talk to God, you just might be amazed at what God will say. Because you see, God wants us to understand He really does the cause of what's going on in our lives. So number one, we see the culmination of the famine. But number two, we see the cause of the famine. In verse number one, again, he gives us the cause. David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered. And the Lord said, "Here's why I've sent a famine to the land. It is for Saul and for his bloody house, because he slew, he murdered, he killed the Gibeonites." And so the cause of this famine, really there were two reasons. Number one was a disobedient man. Now I would challenge you, and I found this interesting when I began to study this, but do you realize that this event is not recorded in the Scripture anywhere else? If we did not have these few verses, we never would have known that Saul was guilty of killing all of these Gibeonites. It was hidden. No one knew about it. I'm sure that there were many that were alive in Israel of that day, and they had no idea that Saul had done that. And I'm sure that, you know, those who were aware of it thought that all of a sudden that, hey, this thing's been covered up. But friends, listen, God was aware of the sin that had taken place. And so many times there are perpetrators of evil who feel as if they have covered their evil actions, and yet God will uncover them. Because you see, God keeps good records, right? God has a good memory. And even though others may be unaware and others may forget and others may cover it up, God never will. God is fully aware always of every evil deed that has taken place. Now, who were these Gibeonites that Saul had murdered? Well, the Gibeonites had a history that really started 400 years earlier. The Gibeonites were a group of people that had made this treaty, and they tricked Joshua 400 years earlier and the Israelites into making a treaty with them so that Israel's army would not destroy them. Do you remember when Israel's army went in and they were possessing the promised land? God told them, now I want you to go in, I want you to wipe out all of the pagans in Canaan. Now that may seem unfair, but God had a reason for doing it. Those pagans were wicked, ungodly people, and God knew that if the Israelites didn't just exterminate them, that they would contaminate the faith of the Jewish people. And so the Gibeonites, they were aware of what was going on, and so they came to Joshua and the elders of Israel, and they said, look, don't destroy us. You have no reason to destroy us. They tricked them into believing that they were from a faraway land, when in reality, they were next door neighbors. And so even though they tricked them into signing this treaty, the Israelites under God were still responsible to keep this treaty because they had sworn unto the Israelites in the name of the Lord God of Israel. And if they were to break that treaty, they would have been guilty of dishonoring the name of God. And so it was a serious thing to break that treaty they had made in the name of the Lord God of Israel. But then Saul comes along many years later, and Saul looked at this as a way to, you might say, feather his own nest, make him look good in the sight of the Israelites. So he broke that treaty, and he slaughtered a bunch of these Gibeonites. Not sure how many that he killed, but he was guilty. And friends, what we learn from that is what I stressed in the introduction. One man's actions can have a great impact on others, because this famine had come to the land of Israel and many people were suffering because of one man's disobedience. Friend, I want you to listen carefully right here. If you're listening, say amen. The land was suffering famine, which was the judgment of God, because murder had polluted the land. And one man's disobedience now was causing a great fallout. Friend, if you don't think that one man's actions can have a serious effect on the lives of others, you just need to read the story of Adam. The Bible says the result of Adam's sin, one man's sin, the result is that the whole world has fallen into sin as the result of that. And so the famine came because of a disobedient man. But the famine also came, and I want you to sit up and pay close attention right here. The famine came because of a delayed repentance. Do you realize that when this famine came, that Saul had been dead for 30 years? 30 years. So for 30 years, God is waiting patiently for them to repent of this national sin. God waits day after day after day after day, and yet there's absolutely no repentance. And boy, what we need to hear this morning is that, listen, this judgment of God, this famine, came upon the land not because of a present sin, but because of a past sin. It was not committed during the days of David. It was committed during the days of Saul. So what had happened 30 years earlier, now this nation was being judged for it because they never had repented of it. You see, this idea of delayed repentance, what a serious, serious thing that is. They tried to cover up this evil rather than dealing with this evil. And you realize that God has no statute of limitations that runs out someday on evil. He doesn't. Let me tell you something about evil actions. They are either repented of or they are dealt with. Now you see why I didn't want to preach this on a Sunday morning. But evil actions, they are not just swept under the rug. They are either repented of or they are dealt with. And I want to tell you what, we'd do a whole lot better to repent of it rather than to let God deal with it. And what I have stirring in my soul this morning is that here is a truth that doesn't just apply to individuals. Here is a truth that applies to nations. And as I think about the judgment of God being poured out upon the nation because of one man's sin 30 years earlier, I have to think to myself, I just wonder if the problems that we are facing today as the United States of America, I wonder if these problems are not the judgment of God on sins of the past and of our nation that have never been properly dealt with. I just wonder if the problems of 2012, if the financial problems and the moral problems and the ethical problems and the political problems and the breakup of the family and on and on and on I could go. I just wonder if these problems could not be traced back to a great sin that occurred in our nation in the past. I just wonder if we are not facing today the judgment of God upon our land for the greatest national sin this country has ever committed when in 1973 our Supreme Court voted to legalize the murder of babies inside of their mother's womb. I wonder if God has not been waiting patiently year after year after year for this nation to repent of that horrible sin. Friend, I want to tell you what a terrible and terrible sin that is that our Supreme Court committed that day. And I really do believe that we could somehow get the favor of God back upon this nation if we would repent. Friend, I say this, and I know it's not popular, but when a nation has a sitting president that signs legislation that if a baby is aborted and lives, that the doctor is not responsible to do all he can do to make sure that child lives, but can basically throw it in the wastebasket, set it over in the corner, and let it die. When a nation has a sitting president who signs that kind of legislation, friend, that's pure evil. Pure evil. Send me the letter. I'll not change my mind. It's pure, pure evil. And if somehow there could be enough folks in this land who would have the guts enough to overturn Roe v. Wade, we just might see the blessing and the favor of God upon this land of ours again. But as long as Christians continue to put pro-choice politicians in office who will make sure Roe v. Wade is never overturned, we will never have the judgment of God off of this land. Friend, I want to tell you, we need to wake up. God is serious about this. God's very serious about this. The Bible tells us over in the book of Numbers, for example, just listening to these fearful verses, these verses ought to put the fear of God in our hearts. In Numbers chapter number 35, in verse number 30, "Whosoever killeth any person, the murderer shall be put to death." You realize that every time that a doctor sticks a needle in the back of the skull of an unborn baby and draws the fluid out, or injects a saline solution inside of the body of that baby, or every time that somebody takes an after-birth pill, or whatever the things are called, every time somebody takes one of those pills, after morning, whatever they call it, to try to stop that pregnancy from happening. They've been promiscuous the night before, and so they just take a pill to make sure nothing happens. You realize that every time that happens, there has been someone who has shed blood. And God Almighty says, "Whosoever killeth any person, that murderer shall be put to death by the mouth of witnesses." He goes on to say in verse number 32 that you shall take no satisfaction for the life of a murderer. In other words, we should never rejoice when a murderer dies. It ought to grieve our hearts. But he says down in verse number 33, you shall not pollute the land wherein you are, for blood defiles the land. See, that's what had happened. The land of Israel had been defiled by the blood that Saul had shed. And God says that has to be dealt with. My stars, Saul did not slay, listen, nowhere near the numbers that we have slain since 1973. And God's judgment was poured out on them as the result of that. Friends, it's time for Christians to take a stand. It's time for Christians to allow our faith to be heard in the voting box. It's time for Christians to turn back the famines of our day that are being produced by the philosophies of pagans. Why did God wait 30 years before he sent the famine? Why has he waited 39 years without swallowing this nation up? I'll tell you why: the grace and the mercy of God. He is giving, as John the Revelator says in Revelation 2, verse 21, he's giving us space to repent. God's delays, though, do not diminish God's judgment. God's delays intensify God's judgment. As a matter of fact, the Old Testament prophet described it like this. He says that when repentance does not occur, that the wrath of God is just being stored up and stored up and stored up and stored up and stored up. Friends, how can we even pray, God bless America, until we can honestly pray, God forgive us for the sin of polluting the land with the blood of the unborn? Do you believe what I'm saying? Now, just in case somebody's here today and you've had an abortion, I'll bet you somebody's here and that has happened in your life. Can I give you a good word? God will forgive you. God will cleanse you. God will take that stain away. You don't have to live with that for the rest of your life. God will remove that from you. So don't live in that. Some of the most emotionally damaged people I've ever known and met have been ladies who have had abortions, and yet they have never come to the Lord and experienced the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus Christ. And yet I have met others who have done that, and they've gotten the peace of God in their hearts as a result of his forgiveness. So what was the cause of this famine? It was the judgment of God on a sin that had not been dealt with. But there's one final thing, and that is the cure, the culmination of the famine, the cause of the famine, the cure of the famine. Now, in verses 2 through 9, we read about the cure, and it's the hanging of these seven sons of Saul, and we wince every time we read that, because we realize that God doesn't ask for human sacrifice, and God never says that, you know, the shedding of the blood of one will atone for someone else. We know that based on looking at it through the eyes of the New Testament. But there's something we can learn here. There are two amazing things we can learn here. And the first thing that we can learn is the principle. And the principle is that the only cure for the famine, the only possible cure for the famine, was to get to the heart of the cause. And the heart of the cause was that God's justice against Saul's sin had not been satisfied. And, you know, the Gibeonites said, look, silver, gold, that's not going to, you know, make reparation for what has happened here. No, a life has to be given for a life. And you see, the principle there is the same principle today, and that is that the wages of sin is death. And so someone had to die for this horrible sin of murder that had been committed. And so we see the principle, but then secondly, we see the protection. Because down in verse number 7, it says that the king spared Mephibosheth. Now Mephibosheth was a candidate for being hung. He was a son of Saul. He was literally the grandson, but he was considered to be one of the sons of Saul. So he was a candidate then for being hung himself. And yet David exempted him. And David said, you don't have to worry about being hung, Mephibosheth. You're not going to die, even though you are a proper candidate. You're in the family of Saul. But what made the difference? What made the difference was that David, you remember, had made a covenant with Mephibosheth's father, a guy by the name of Jonathan. And because David had made a covenant with Mephibosheth, now he was protected and his life was spared. Friends, you see, the actions of one can greatly impact others. And because of the actions of Adam, we are all guilty. Listen, we deserve the justice of God. And God's justice will be poured out on us one day unless we are in covenant relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. But when we come to Him and we trust Him and we ask for His forgiveness and He becomes our personal Savior, then we enter into that covenant relationship with Jesus Christ and we are exempted from the death penalty. Because someone else has taken care of that penalty on our behalf. And just as Mephibosheth was spared, and the justice of God was satisfied because of the sons of Saul who died, the justice of God has been satisfied against us because the Son of God who has died on our behalf. And when that sacrifice was made, God was pleased. Because the Bible tells us, as I read earlier in the latter part of verse 14, then God stopped the famine. And God began once again to bless the land because God's justice had been satisfied. You know, the subject that you hear a few sermons on today is the justice of God. When was the last time you went in a Baptist church and heard a sermon on the justice of God? We hear a lot of sermons about the love of God, few about the justice of God. And I can't understand that because did you know you can't rightly talk about the love of God without talking about the justice of God? You can't separate the two. You talk about the love of God without the justice of God, all you have is this weak, syrupy sentimentalism. Where was the best place where the love of God ever was demonstrated? It was at the cross. What was happening at the cross? God's justice was being satisfied. God's justice here had to be satisfied. And do you realize that today, because of the amazing mercy of God, we don't have to worry about the justice of God because God deals with us in grace and He deals with us in mercy. The Bible says that when we come to Christ and, listen, God's justice is satisfied, then God looks at us and says, you know what? You are now justified. And what does that mean that we are justified? It means that God declares us righteous because of the work of Christ, even though we occasionally sin. That's what it means to be justified. October the 31st, 1976, I said yes to Jesus, and God said, Craig, you are now justified. I am declaring you righteous based on the finished work of my Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I've heard a lot of people misuse this word justified. They break it up into these little syllables, just if I'd. And they say that what it means is just as if I'd never sinned. So when I get saved, God looks at me and says, you know what? It is just as if you had never sinned. Friend, that is too shallow. That is too weak. That is untrue. Justified means this. It means even though I had sinned terribly, that when I put my faith in Christ, God declared me righteous. I had sinned so badly that I won an award for it. And so did you. And yet God looks at us and declares us as being righteous. A couple of weeks ago, I went out in the backyard, fired up the tiller. I was going to plant me some new potatoes. And man, there was dirt and dust flying everywhere. By the time that I got finished, about all you could see were the whites of my eyes and my teeth. Man, was I dirty. I walked into the house, got me a bar of soap, jumped into the shower, and I took me a bath. I could have gotten out, stood before the mirror, and says, ha, just as if I'd never been dirty. But friend, listen, that would have not adequately described the power and the value of the soap and the water. More accurately, I should have looked into that mirror and says, man, once I was filthy, but now I'm clean because of the soap and the water. To be justified means that we say, you know what? Once we were filthy, once we were dirty, once we were so nasty and stained with sin, but now because of the work of one, Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and we are free. That's what it means to be justified. And friend, God's justice will be satisfied either on the person of Jesus or on us. And the good news is when we say yes to the Lord Jesus, we never have to worry again about the justice of God. It is satisfied. Would you stand, please? Heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. No one looking around. Can you honestly, before God today, say, I know that I have been justified because I have put my faith, my personal faith and trust in Jesus Christ? Do you have that assurance and that peace in your heart? If not, and you have a desire to know that and have that, I'm going to ask you to do something very simple. Just step out of your seat, come forward, tell one of our ministers you want to give your life to Jesus Christ today. You want God's justice to be satisfied through your personal faith and trust in Christ. Are you here today and you need a church home and the Spirit of God has led you here to this place? You come today. Here today and you need to pray. Just need to pray. The altar is always open. But our Father, we do thank you for the lesson that we learned from this famine experience of David and Israel. God, how I pray that the lessons that we learned today would be applied to our lives to make us better be the salt and the light this week in our community that you've called us to be. God, my heart goes out to those who are here today who do not have the assurance, the peace of God in their hearts that Jesus is Savior and Lord of their lives. I pray today they would come. For those that you have sent to this place to help us to fight the good fight of faith, I pray that today they would come and unite with this church family. And I pray for any other needs, God, that people would turn to you today and find you as you are to be ever sufficient. In Jesus' name I pray.